Now, as it turns out, the most respected journal in the field of material sciences, and material sciences is a technical area that is a multidisciplinary area of physics, chemistry, and engineering, and they look at water and glass. And this journal called Langmuir is published by the American Chemical Society. Okay? And as it turns out, a group of scientists in India that work for the government, for what's called the IIT, the India Institute of Technology, very respected scientific institution, sort of like our NIH. They did a series of studies with six homeopathic medicines, all metals, all minerals, gold, silver, copper, tin, platinum. And they diluted them 1 to 100, 6 times, 30 times, and 200 times. Once again, if you do it 1 to 100, just 12 times, you shouldn't have any of the molecules remaining of gold, silver, copper, tin, platinum, none, let alone 30 times, let alone 200 times. But in fact, using three different types of spectroscopy, they were able to measure nanoparticles of each of the different substances. So what do the skeptics say? Our medicines are contaminated with the thing we say is in them. Can you say that with a straight face? I can't. So as it turns out, most of our hormones and what are called cell signaling agents operate at this extremely low level too. That free estrogen operates at what's called 12x, which is 1 to 10, 12 times. Testosterone, 9x. Here's acetylcholine at 16x, which means, once again, diluted 1 to 10, 16 times. And the ones that I was talking about, 6C, that's like 1 to 100, 6 times, or 1 to 10, 12 times. So, you know, all this is, you know, small doses. Homeopathic doses are even stronger. And the point is that none of these homeopathic medicines will have any effect unless our body is hypersensitive and really needs it. And ultimately, in all of evolution, that every animal on this planet, every plant, will be hypersensitive to what it needs. A shark will be hypersensitive to blood. And you think about the volume of water in the ocean, and yet they can sense blood in the water at a distance. And if you've ever read all the different animal and insect books that are around about the hypersensitivity that each of them has, you know, I understand moss can be hypersensitive to pheromones of moss of their own species, being 2 miles away and then even being upwind from each other. I mean, they don't have OK Cupid, so they have to have that sensitivity. But what's interesting about pheromones is that, you know, moss only smell moth pheromones and not rhinoceros pheromones. And that's probably a good thing, because those rhinos are pretty horny. Okay. And by the way, so pheromones are not only small in dose and based upon similars, so that only a moth can be in touch with their own moth. So it's on that resonance level. And in fact, although we in homeopathy have referred to homeopathy as the principle of similars or the law of similars, I like to think of this as a type of resonance in medicine. Because if you think about it too, if there was a piano over here, and I hit the C note of that piano, and there's a piano in the far corner of this room, the C note would reverberate all C notes of this piano, and even all C notes of the piano at the other side of the room. And so ultimately, when a homeopath gives you a particular homeopathic medicine, if it's not the right one, it's like a magnet and a piece of plastic. There's no affinity, no charge. But when there is a hypersensitivity, then it's almost like a radar effect, and it's like your hair stand on end to reach out to it. So, in terms of science and research, the Swiss government did what was the largest and most comprehensive review of research on homeopathy. And what happened was is that they decided to write a series, they commissioned a series of reports. And I'll later talk about one of the negative reviews that was published. But that only looked at a very small part of the research. The bigger view was one that I'll now talk about. And they found not only hundreds of double-blind placebo-controlled trials, they also looked at what are called systematic reviews or what are called meta-analyses. And they found that there was a trend in favor of homeopathy at least in 20 of the 22 and 5 where the results were even stronger. And then the report in particular highlighted that upper respiratory tract infections and respiratory allergic reactions, there were 24 studies with a positive result in favor of homeopathy, and then 6 of the 7 controlled studies that didn't just compare homeopathy with a placebo, but compared it with conventional medicine. And 6 out of 7 found the homeopathic medicine to be more effective than the conventional medical intervention. So they also reviewed basic science work, certain botanical studies, animal studies, in vitro studies on human cells, a systematic review of cell cultures, and they concluded that that homeopathic medicine seemed to have a regulatory, balancing, and normalizing effect and possess a specific physical structure. Then they did a cost-effectiveness study where they compared all the costs associated with medical doctors that did conventional medicine. And they had a group of doctors that did alternative medicine. And then they had a group that did homeopathic medicine. And in fact, as it turns out, the alternative medicine doctors and the conventional medical doctors actually had approximately the same cost. Now, the difference was is the alternative doctors had a lot of costs of the vitamins and herbs and nutrients. And they also had a fair amount of lab studies because they need to do those lab reports to make those determinations. The homeopaths did not need nearly as much lab studies. The cost of the medicines were much cheaper, but the cost for the physician, him or herself, was higher because in homeopathy, it's more labor intensive. Whereas a doctor can see a patient in 5 and or 10 minutes and know what to do, the homeopath will commonly need 30 minutes or 60 minutes. Now, mind you, the skeptics commonly say, see, that does it. They have more time, and that time is the way that they then get over typhoid, that they get over these serious diseases. Really, if it was just time, then our best friends should be reimbursed because they spend time with us. Or psychologists would be our best healers, because we spend 50 minutes with them, and often once a week, not every month, like you do when you go to a homeopath, or less. I mean, homeopathy is specifically set up for not encouraging the placebo effect, because many of us that practice professional homeopathy commonly give only 1 or 2 doses, and then say, come back in a month or two. Now, we're in touch with them in certain situations more than in just a month or two. But the point is that one has to be very clever and in a serious state of denial to believe that homeopathy is primarily the placebo effect. But even some specific studies. This was a study published in The Lancet. And actually, this was the third of 4 studies that this group of researchers at the University of Glasgow did. And the University of Glasgow is Europe's largest medical school. And they did this double-blind randomized study with asthma patients. And they did something unique. The way they chose to individualize treatment is they did conventional allergy testing. So they found out what they're allergic to. The most common substance, by the way, was something called house dust mite. But whatever it was, they would then make it into a medicine and dilute it 1 to 10, 30 times. Once again, that's beyond that Avogadro's number. That's beyond what they would think there should be any of the molecules left. By the way, one of the things I want to say about this Avogadro's number has nothing to do with homeopathy because it doesn't account for bubbles and nanobubbles. It doesn't account for double distilled water that blanches against the sidewalls and has silica fragments fall off. That's not in the equation. The equation is just this mathematical precept that says 1 to 10 24 times. But biology is too complex. That's you cannot create a mathematical formula. And so whenever anyone brings up Avogadro's number in a discussion of homeopathy, that's a warning sign to say they don't get it. They don't understand how these medicines are made, and they're putting up, you know, fog screens to cloud the situation. So in this particular case, it was a relatively small study of only 28 asthma patients. Now, when you do a small study, you have to have even really significant differences in order for there to be what's called statistical significance. And I should say that in this study, they tested each of the homeopathic medicines by an independent lab to make certain that no homeopathic medicine was infiltrated with a real drug. And then the patients were assessed by both a homeopathic physician and a conventional physician. And then what they noticed in terms of the differences was within the first week. And in this case, 82% of the homeopathic patients experienced some type of improvement, and about 39% of the placebo patients experienced that similar degree of improvement. So then they did a study on perennial allergic rhinitis. Once again, it was randomized, double-blind, and placebo-controlled. So they didn't actually have asthma, but they had the respiratory allergy symptoms. And their improvement was with 50 patients. And there was, you know, once again, significant improvement. And then they evaluated all four of their studies. And there was literally a tenfold improvement with those people giving a placebo. And this was published in this journal called the British Medical Journal. And there was an editorial on that issue that ultimately said, we don't believe that this is for studies that are just by accident. It was a statement in support of this research. But then now they've gone into this fog bank again, and they forgot all about what this editorial has said. So actually, here it was. It may be time to confront the conclusion that homeopathy and placebo differ. This may be more plausible than the conclusion that their trials have been produced serial false positives. So anyway, now here's another more recent condition called fibromyalgia, which is for a while was considered controversial, but it's not controversial anymore. It's recognized as a rheumatological problem. I'll talk about a study that was published in a journal called Rheumatology. But in this first study, which was published in the British Medical Journal, they did something very interesting. They took a homeopathic medicine called Roos Tox, which is poison ivy. Now, poison ivy in homeopathy is used for certain skin problems, because that's what it causes. But if you ever had the displeasure of taking poison ivy internally, it has an effect upon connective tissue in a way that it creates what's called the rusty gate syndrome.